My name is Erica Gamet and welcome to my video channel. Today I want to talk a little bit about using GREP in InDesign. What it is, where it lives, what it's all about. So as they say, without further ado, let's get right into it. So, GREP, what is it? And why is everyone so afraid of it? Well, it sounds scary. It sounds, I don't know, it's an acronym, first of all. Acronyms can be scary, just for whatever reason, because they stand for something and we don't know what it is yet. So that might be why. Also because it kind of sounds like a disease that you'd rather not tell people you've contracted. I've got the GREP. But I swear it's really not as scary as it sounds. At its core, I guess it's very technical, and I'm not going to get into why it's called what it's called very much, but it has its roots in Unix, and you might see it in things like Perl. I might call that a language. I don't know if that's a language or a scripting, I don't know, or a programming language. I don't know the technical term, and frankly, I don't care, because for me, when I'm talking about GREP, I'm talking about GREP in InDesign. All right, so GREP. Why is it called GREP? We're going to start with that, get that question out of the way. It stands for Global Regular Expression Parsing, or printing. So I've heard it both ways. But the thing we need to really worry about is that middle part, the R and the E, regular expression. And just hold on to that concept for a little while there. But what we're doing is we're doing something that when we're using it in InDesign, and InDesign uses a smaller subset of GREP than is out there and available. What we're doing when we're working with GREP in InDesign is that we are trying to do what we do as designers is we create a visual or a pattern. We find patterns in things and we lay things out in patterns. And what GREP does is find patterns of text, and then with InDesign, we get to not only find those patterns of text, but we get to do something to that text that we have found that fits that pattern. So we're going to talk about that in future videos. This video, I just want to make sure you kind of get comfortable with what the idea of GREP is and where it lives in InDesign. And also, I want to show you what GREP is. So let's do that first, because I want to show you what it is that this GREP thing is all about. How can it help me as a designer using InDesign? So I'm going to open up a file here and just kind of show you what it does. Some examples that you might be able to use as a designer. So for instance, we've probably all seen this where we get phone numbers, formatted in different ways. So for instance, you might have dashes between the digits, you might have nothing, you might have everything offset by dashes and parentheses. And now obviously I'm speaking about North American phone numbers. Your phone number may look differently depending on where you live. But this happens to us a lot as designers. We'll get phone numbers that have been formatted either by different designers who have worked on the project over the years, or maybe the phone numbers came in through a web form and people entered them differently. And what we need to do is we need to create them so that they look all the same. So over here, this is how we want our phone numbers to end up looking. We want to say, perhaps put dots in between all the different components of a phone number, the area code, the prefix, and the digits afterwards. So we want to have consistency. But what we need to do is we need to figure out how to find all of this that could be in these different formats. I only have three here as an example. But how we can find those, create a pattern that says look for it in this way. We don't know what the phone numbers are or what the digits are. We don't care. We just know that they fit into a certain pattern. We need to find that pattern and say, great, take that pattern and make me this. All right, so how do we do that? We use GREP. And again, in future videos, we're going to look at actually creating that there. So what happens is we can say, all right, let's take this number, these sets of numbers, and format it like so. The other types of things that we can do is take styling and say something like this. Let's come down here and say we want this one. It's a price, $24.99. And what we'd really like is to have it formatted so that the dollar sign is superscripted as are the cents. So we can actually build that in as well, so that as we're typing, we type 24.99 and the 99 is automatically superscripted. But again, that price could easily be 10.58, right? So we don't know what the price is, so we can't just do a normal find change, for instance, and say find every time it says 24.99 and do something to it. We're trying to speed things up, not slow things down. So that's another place that we can use grep. So where does it live in InDesign? So since version, I believe CS4, we have had it in two places. Before that, we had it in one place, but we have it in the find change dialog box, and we also find it in styles. So I'm gonna open up the find change dialog box by doing Command or Control F, and I get my find change dialog box, and we have, along the top here, we have four tabs. We're used to going into the text one and saying, find the word blue and maybe formatting it so it actually becomes blue. But what if we have several colors and we want to change them, not specifically to their own color, but we want to take any time a word that is a color, green or blue or gray or purple or orange, and we want to change that to either another color, or we want to change the font, we want to make it bigger, bolder, a different color, and underlined. We really want every time a color appears, a color by name appears, that we want it to have a specific look in our document. That's where we need to go to the second tab called GREP. And when we do that, we're going to see that, for instance, this one's a really long code that's in here, and that's basically that phone number one, and we'll look at that in a future video. What you will normally see when you start out is you'll see nothing in there. So there's nothing in any of the boxes that are here, and it's just saying, great, fill in a grep, or I'm sorry, a grep expression. So you might hear me use that term, or a regular expression. I tend to say grep expression just because I want to keep reminding people that we are working with grep. The technical term is regular expression, but again, I'm not so worried about the technical term, just so that we all know what we're doing and what we're going to create in the end. So in here, I would put in some sort of expression that would create a pattern that says, look for these phone numbers that are formatted this certain way and then do something to them. And again, we're not going to do that in this video. I just want to show you where we do that. We do that in the find change dialog box. Now, where this comes in handy is all your text is already entered, whether you've entered it yourself or you've imported it from somewhere else. Now, with any find change, we can run it and fix everything. But if our text changes, we have to do find change again. So it's sort of an ongoing thing that happens. But what you can do in the find change dialog box is you can reorder things and add and subtract. So for instance, if I wanted to find everything that fit this particular pattern, and I wrote out the grep expression, but in the end I also wanted to remove the area code, because maybe they're all the same, maybe it's a list of 800 numbers and they actually are all 800. So maybe we need to remove that, or maybe we live in a town that we don't even need to dial the area code, if those still exist. But a lot of places you have to dial the area code. But maybe we want to remove those. Or maybe we want to add something to that. We want to say plus one space and then the phone number so that we know that they're all in the United States. So again, find change lets us not only find the things and style the things in some way, but we can also add to, subtract, rearrange whatever we need to with those items, as opposed to when we build it into a style. Now that's what I did in this instance down here. This is actually a style. Now where that comes in handy, I've built that into my paragraph style. So I'm gonna open up my paragraph style panel here, and I have one called prices. So again, this is just a paragraph style, but along the side of your paragraph style, along the panes, we have something called grep style. When I click in there, I can see that I have some grep styles assigned to it. And again, we're not going to worry about all this right now in this video, what this means, but basically you can see I've done something so that it automatically styles the dollar sign in the cents in some way. I've told it a secret pattern that says when you encounter this in text that you've assigned to the prices paragraph style to, then do something to that text. And we're going to apply character styles in this case. So it's kind of like a nested style. If you've used nested styles, you know that you can add a character style on top of your paragraph style, but it's built into the style so that in this case, when it fits that pattern, it's automatically applied. Where that comes in handy is the fact that as you're typing, if you type something that fits that pattern, it will automatically be styled for you. There's no running fine change. If your text changes, that's fine. If it changes so it doesn't fit the pattern, the styling goes away. If you introduce something new and it fits that pattern, then it automatically gets styled. What you cannot do in a style, though, is add or subtract or reorder that text. So basically, I can say, hey, when you find a dollar sign, superscript it. But I can't say, when you find a dollar sign, get rid of that dollar sign. So hopefully that kind of, just explains why you would use one over the other. And sometimes it's frustrating because you think, oh, I'll use it in the style because then it'll just be there. And any text you've already typed and you assign that style to automatically gets changed. And anything new you add automatically gets changed. But you realize you needed to add that plus one space to the phone number or something like that. So that won't work in the style dialog box. So that's basically what GREP is. You find text that fits a specific pattern. You tell it what the pattern is. And that pattern can be quite inclusive like this. Three things that look entirely different to me, even though in my head I know those are phone numbers, but they're all formatted differently, and I can just click it, and we'll just actually do that really quick. I'm just going to click on that, and I'll show you in a future video how to actually set this up, but I'm just going to go ahead and say, in this particular story, change that all, and it's going to change all three of them, and went ahead and made it magenta for you. But again, now I have everything formatted exactly as I expect it to be because all of it fit that pattern that was in that particular GREP expression. So I hope that clears up some of the GREP mystery. I don't want it to be scary. I hope you'll watch all the future videos that I have on GREP and realize that there's a lot of places in your workflow where this will come in handy. I hope just seeing a couple of things you think, oh, I wonder if I can use that on this particular job that I'm working on. And you'll see that GREP will save you a lot of time, and I'll talk about resources and how to learn and how we build expressions in the next few videos that I do for GREP. So I hope that helps, and I hope you will join me again. Thanks. All right, well, I hope you enjoyed that introduction to using GREP in InDesign. I know it's one of my favorite things to talk about, and I'm gonna have several videos on that in the coming weeks, just so you know. So get ready for some more GREP goodness. If you liked this video, be sure to like it or give it a thumbs up. Leave me a comment below as well, or hit me up on Twitter or Instagram, @ErikaGamet, and ask me a question. It could be about this video, something you want to see in a new video, any topic you'd like me to talk about, let me know, or something that's stumping you maybe with GREP, maybe with something else. Whenever you do contact me, whether it's in the comments or on social media, be sure to use the #LearnWithErika. I can find it easier that way. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed it. I look forward to the next video. I'm gonna have some more videos coming up on GREP really soon. So until next time, bye-bye.